We're on. Welcome, everyone. We are grateful that you can join us here for this live streaming and on Google Hangout. And thank you to our tech support here and Eric for getting us all set up here tonight. It's very cozy and comfortable here in the Living Miracles studio. And the title tonight is Back to God, Experiencing A Course in Miracles. Kind of a short version of Unwind Your Mind, Back to God, Experiencing A Course in Miracles.
So our friends Lisa and Jason, they're on a tour. Their tour is called Unwind Your Mind. So we said, okay, our gathering is called Back to God.
Yeah. So those of you who are new to us, this is a book that's just coming out, and it has just come out. It's published, but it's kind of building a momentum. And it's a pretty big book, but I think we can cover all 528 pages or whatever tonight easily, because it's basically three books in one, so no problem for us. One live streaming, we can cover the core of it, because we really want to go into the experience and extend the experience. And really, I guess oftentimes people do ask, how? Is that one of the questions that you were getting preceding this live stream? How do you go back to God? How do you return your awareness to the awareness of God's love? So that's really one thing that we can address. And really in the books, I guess for some of you, this book was really taken and has come out of the Teacher of Teachers website, miracleshome.org. It's been about 20 years in the making, so we're going to be addressing some ideas in here and really bringing in our experiences to it too as well. And really it's three books, but the first book is Laying the Foundation, and then the second book is Unlearning the World, and then the third book is Transfer of Training, which you always have a spark in your eye when we get to Transfer of Training, because that's probably right where your mind's at right now. That's what you're most excited about. So we would like to talk about this experience and experiencing the essence of A Course in Miracles tonight. And also we would like to leave some time for questions. You can type those questions in. Eric is standing by, and we can be able to perhaps handle some of the questions that are typed in from around the world. And then also we have, I guess you could say, a studio audience, a few studio audiences. Looks like a monastery studio audience, and one in Mexico, and one here in the Camus Metaphysical Center. So you can also unmute your mics during those segments and just ask any kind of questions that come to mind, because we're just here for the joy of sharing the experience and really just living in a consistent state of mind where you feel one with God, one with everything, connected with the universe, completely wholly connected without any blips, any little segments or wavers. And this is the whole package tonight. We'll be talking about the whole package. So we might have some new people on. Maybe should we introduce ourselves in case there's new people watching?
Sure.
Saying, who are these characters?
Okay. You want me to start?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. Hi. My name's Francis. I feel really grateful to be able to have the Course in Miracles as my inroad to a profound opening experience, an opening of the heart and opening of the mind, to have a consistent experience of this vast, what you call it, the experience of God, or the experience of peace, the experience of freedom in the mind. So, the Course in Miracles is something that myself and all the people here in the community, we use as something that we practice 24/7. And that is actually what attracted me first to this community and by David's teaching, is that this is total. This is something that, you know, truth is true and truth is total. And when I first pick up the course and try to practice on my own, I felt there was like almost like internal conflict living in the world and following all the laws of the world. At that point, was very much into health and, you know, focusing on what I eat. And when I pick up the course, I just thought, you know, in so many aspects of my life, I could not live with integrity of myself. I cannot live a life that I believe food is a cause or anything else is a cause, and at the same time practice the course saying that the mind is the only cause of anything. So yeah, so that was just what really drawn me to the community, and in the last few years just being here and really immersed in the practice aspect of, you know, the metaphysics of the course and also the metaphysics that David put in this book just has been pretty amazing. Yes, really pretty amazing. So it's me.
Thank you. Thank you, Francis. And I'm David, and I've really just given my life over to apply myself to have an experience, and then having the experience, just extending that experience without exception. And so I'm thrilled to be able to have that as a life's calling, because it is life to me. That's what life is this experience, and you can't really live apart from it or think apart from it or be apart from it. It's just an ongoing experience. And we will be mentioning the book, A Course in Miracles, tonight. We do it quite often. There are times when we just talk about our experiences and the ideas without mentioning it, but most of the time when we make reference to it or talk about it, it's just another pathway back to God, one among many. But even though it's one among many, it does say in the book that you will believe this course entirely or not at all. And so that's good to know in the outset. That's a good idea to kind of open your mind to, that you'll believe it entirely or not at all. So it's not something that you can kind of do half-heartedly or haphazardly or partially. You can't really experience truth in a partial way, because truth is whole. It's holistic. And also, this line in the course that really struck me at the beginning was, this course has everything that you need. And if you take those words literally, then you can give yourself over to it in a way that if you apply it, you don't really need another book, or you don't really need to devote your life to reading lots of things, which I can say I was doing when the course came along. I was trying to be as open-minded as possible, and I think that was very helpful. But there was an energy and a direct contact that I felt I made when I opened to A Course in Miracles. And so this is something that we've used. And I have to say that in my immersion in A Course in Miracles, I felt such a direct contact with Christ and with God and with the Holy Spirit, that it did have this strong feeling wash over me, like, wow, this is the last book that I ever need to read. I had that feeling. It also washed away any kind of thought of a future of writing books, because I feel like God is the author of reality, and then this book was such a reflection of that presence, and it was so clear and so direct that I thought I will never need to write a book. And I still have that feeling. I don't have a need. And then when I look at this book, I kind of open it and look into it, and it's really a book of dialogues, because the teachings have come through me very verbally, and so it's not like a book that just kind of talks at you. It's just dialogues, questions, answers. It's kind of been like a synopsis of how my life has gone since I got the course. So even though books may come out with my name on the cover or something, a number of books or whatever, and people may have a little page, say author's page or whatever, and this and that, I don't really identify with any of that. And when I look at the books that even have come, here's another one over here, and I look in here, this one's called Going Deeper, and it's the same thing. I open it up and it says friend. So what about holy relationship? It's a question. And oh, here's another one. Sarah's got us all stocked up here. This one's called Awakening to A Course in Miracles. The same thing. It's just a bunch of dialogues. I even have a friend in Florida. She says, when are you going to, you know, write a regular book? And I just have never had any intention of doing that. And it all started with this feeling when I was working with the course, like I thought, I'll never need to read another book or write another book. And at the time, I remember I quit reading the newspaper and quit reading the stack of books by my bed, and I was just taken into an experience. And then after that, I remember at one point when somebody was asking me something about this book or that book, I just said, I don't read. Just like in the movie Being There, where Chauncey Gardner says, I like to watch. I just say, oh, I don't read. And people go, what? What do you mean? I don't even think of it as like an activity anymore. If something crosses my eyes or people write a letter to me or an email, but I don't even think of it as like reading anymore. It's just everything's all blended together. So that's part of the experiencing A Course in Miracles, that, if you go fully into this experience of, we'll call it God or oneness or divine love or whatever, then your mind is not in the same state of mind that it's previously seemed to be in. And it's delightful. It's a delightful experience. It's a delightful way to live. In fact, it seems like it, in the end, it's the only way. There's nothing else there. So we can talk about that, and we can also talk about like those three books contained in this one book, Unwind Your Mind Back to God. When I say the first one, Sarah was saying, like, even just reading the table of contents of each of the books, it's kind of like a wash over your mind. But even if I just use the title of the first book inside the book, Laying the Foundation, what does that mean to you when you think of your own experiences opening to spirituality? And you have talked to me and in interviews before about how initially your encounter with A Course in Miracles seemed to have a pretty much of an intellectual component, and because you were a student, a very good student, and when you read it, I guess that was part of your mindset at the time about learning concepts or learning something from a book. And you've talked to me a little bit about that's how it started out for you. It seemed like you had a large Course in Miracles meetup group in Sydney, and then you pretty much felt like you were guiding the group by teaching the concepts. But how does it, now that you know about these three aspects, laying the foundation, unlearning the world, and transfer of training, what does that bring to mind when you hear laying the foundation? Really experientially for you, what do you feel was laying the foundation? Maybe even beyond teaching it intellectually, because I know people who try to read it, teach it intellectually, study it and everything, and some of them feel pretty chaotic. If you said to them, did that lay the foundation, they may say, I don't know, maybe it's helping move in that direction, but what does it feel like for you? What was that laying the foundation?
Well, I know this, like the content of this book. I remember years ago when the content was only available through audio online, I was really just listening through, and the title was very attractive to me at the point, and I was thinking, oh my God, laying the foundation. I really want to lay the foundation. I want to lay a very solid foundation so that I can undo the world and transfer the training, and this is very important. I can't miss this step. That was, you know, my intellectual mind was telling me, you know, this is important. But at that point, I guess the mind is active and it's full of questions. It doesn't really settle down into this full trust of the spirit or of the divine providence. It has so many questions and so many suspicions and so many doubts, and it wants to find some kind of things that I can hold on to and some kind of answers that can at some level resonate. For example, like, what is karma? What is reincarnation? Does the course, you know, teach that? And what is miracle? You know, those kind of questions right now after experience, you know, just practice the principles for years. Those are not the questions we talk about every day, but those are the foundations that's been laid solidly, and at the, you know, especially at the at stage when the mind was active and really wants some kind of answers in the form of concepts and experience, other people's experience, and all these concepts around the world that we have learned throughout our lives, and how does that relate to what the course is teaching? You know, it's almost like it needs a bridge to allow the mind to just really, okay, unwind or relax. And that's what I, now looking back, that was the foundation, was just those other questions, because you can see in that first book, there are just all these questions that I guess your students or your friend have collected and asked you over so many years around, you know, relationships, around life, around bodies, symptoms, health, like all of that. And that's been really helpful.
Yeah, so I think that I'm sensing too that this laying the foundation is essential. And also, it seems to have a lot to do with curiosity. Like sometimes they say some children are naturally curious. They just have a real kind of open sense. What's this? What's that mean? What does this mean? Why? Why? I mean, I remember going to a movie theater one time, and a mother and her children sat behind me, and really every 5 seconds of the movie, it was about an hour and a half movie, every 5 seconds of the movie, it was like, what's that? And why did this? And what's it? It was just question after question after question. And I have to say, it wasn't at all annoying or irritating to me. It was actually delightful. I mean, I thought, oh, how delightful to be in a movie theater and hearing this flow of cadence of really curious questions. And I think that's a big aspect of laying the foundation is giving yourself permission and allowance to really let your natural curiosity come up. And I mean, by curiosity, it can be about everything. It can be about all the assumptions of the world, or who you seem to be in the world, or your roles, your situations, maybe some crises that have happened to you, or maybe you're even a little curious if you've had some mystical experiences and you wonder, what was that? Where did that come from? Or why did it go, you know, when it left? Or it, I think it's part of laying the foundation is like a natural sense of curiosity. And it's interesting that these books that I just was holding up have been mirroring my own curiosity, that I had a curiosity at the beginning for God or for spirit, even though I didn't really know didn't have a direct experience, but I did have a curiosity, and then I allowed myself to ask questions and question everything, really. I mean, I felt like the course was just like a cheerleader. Jesus saying to learn this course requires willingness to question every value that you hold. Not one can be kept hidden or it will obscure your learning. one sentence, and I thought, wow, that's amazing. I want to question everything. I've never had anybody on earth say question everything. I would come across, you know, wonderful teachers like Krishnamurti that seem to have that same kind of vibe, like have a curiosity, have a childlike curiosity to question everything. And a student of his, Tara Singh, who was also into the course, that was an early inspiration of just having that curiosity. So it certainly is not the end, but it's a great beginning. And I think when we interact with people in our communities and we do talks and gatherings around the world, they're very much open discussions. It's like heart-to-heart discussions. It's not really like a lecture or somebody telling somebody else something. It's more just a curiosity that we come together and we're drawn together, and then we explore topics together, or we explore what's underneath these perceptions, and we have an openness. I think you have to have a bit of openness and willingness to be truly curious. Mm. If you already think you know, then it's like the portal is closed, mm-hmm. and the mind is closed, and mm-hmm. and really you can't go on an authentic journey to who you are if you've already got a set of beliefs and concepts and assumptions that you aren't willing to question. So to me, that feels like that's really important in laying the foundation. Mm-hmm. So we would say to everyone, you know, we welcome you in that. I have always found it delightful when I'm talking to somebody or I'm talking to a group and someone comes in and they just have this energy of like, what's going on here? And they jump right in, or even children jumping into discussions and things. You start to realize that there really are no interruptions in this thing we call life. It's just a reflection of where your mind's at. And when you have an openness to be curious and to start to accept your emotions and let them come up, and also to be curious about what's underneath those emotions, then I think you're on the road to authentic awakening. And then once we started getting into unlearning the world, wow, that's a whole new shift of gears from curiosity, because a lot of times people who even study the course will study the book for weeks or months or years, sometimes decades even. It's been out long enough to now be decades, so people in study groups going around and reading it and maybe raising some questions and then occasionally getting into some pondering and discussion, trying to come up with answers, which is typically what you do in education. You are taught that you can raise questions, but you also are looking for answers. But usually the answers go around and around, and most of the time in a circle, because they're just theories or hypotheticals or ponderings, and then someone will say, let's read the next paragraph, and then the next paragraph answers all the questions, and people are sitting there like, what's going on here? This is amazing. We thought we just tried to answer that. We all pondered, and then the book's got the answers in the next paragraph, and then it goes on and on like that until after they've read it for some months or years, they're more hushed. Sometimes they'll just come together and read and let it kind of wash over them, and then not even interject all these bantering kind of questions, because they know that if they keep reading on, something's happening. There's a transformation of consciousness happening. So, you know, we're really grateful for the course and for those initial times. I used it kind of like an I Ching. I would pop the book open, I would have the question in mind or the prayer, and then I would close my eyes and I would just pop the book open and get the answer that way. So, you know, like almost like a letting a genie out of a bottle and having all the answers just spoon-fed to you. There's no set way to do the course. The workbook has some instructions, but as far as which book you're drawn to first, really depends on where you're at in your mind. There's not a structure in that way. But once we start to get into unlearning the world, then I think trust, you mentioned trust.
What does that unlearning the world involve in this book?
Well, I think unlearning the world is really more like traditional Buddhism, for example, is empty your mind of everything you think and think you know. And there's a lot of traditions that talk about emptying out whatever you think you have in your consciousness, emptying out the contents of consciousness. And so the title of the book is Unwind Your Mind Back to God. So in one sense, the unlearning of the world is part of this unwinding. Like you've believed things that aren't true, you've taken on assumptions, you have a whole set of beliefs, none of which are true, and you have to start to unwind from that belief system in the sense that it would be too frightening to pop out of it. So it's more of like an unwinding. And as I've sent some review copies of this book out to friends, I've had more than one say, what a perfect name for a book, because that's exactly how it feels my life is going. I feel like I'm unwinding from the world.
Mm.
And then they see, you know, Unwind Your Mind Back to God, and they're writing into me now saying, this is perfect, it's the perfect title. But it's more of like an unlearning, which I always thought was kind of fascinating about A Course in Miracles, to call it A Course in Miracles. When we think of a course, we think of learning.
Mm.
And like even you working with A Course in Miracles and teaching the concepts, teaching what you would learn and learning the concepts from reading the book and then teaching them to mm-hmm. strengthen them. At some point, I think you start to realize that it's kind of a clever way of drawing you in, but that you're not learning a damn thing. You're working with this and you're starting to see, oh my gosh, I'm actually unlearning everything that I've ever believed in. And unlearning the world is just synonymous to the ego, because the world was made by the ego, so it's a pretty good synonym. I mean, you have to see it in the context of the course, which is that it's a linear world, and it's a time-space cosmos, mm. and that eternity or spirit, you know, creates like itself. So if spirit creates like spirit, or eternity creates like eternity, the time-space cosmos is not eternal at all, and it isn't spirit at all. It's not changeless. It's ever changing. Mm. Spirit's eternal and changeless, and it's very temporary.
Mm-hmm.
And everything we know about the cosmos now, even with physics and quantum physics, it's all telling us that it's really not spirit at all. There could be something underneath it or something at the essence, at the core of it, but as it's perceived, you know, with the consciousness and the mind and the five senses, it's certainly not eternal. So that is what needs to be unlearned. And in one sense, it's part of this emptying out that they talk about in Buddhism. Also, in the course, in lesson 189 in the workbook, you know, simply do this, be still, lay aside all thoughts of what you are, what God is. It sounds very Buddhist. It's wonderful when you're working with the course with all the Christian language, because it's a lot of people who have an experience of Jesus or Jesus' teachings through the Bible think that Jesus is a dualist, a dual teacher. And then when you get to the course, surprise, surprise, it's completely non-dual. There's, you know, it's using words from the dualistic world of the ego, but oh, where the direction is going, it's not going to maintain duality at all.
Mm.
When you work with the course and you learn it entirely, as it suggests, you know, believe this source will be believed entirely, you're not going to be left holding heaven and hell or love and hate. It's just going to be a total experience of love.
Mm-hmm.
There is only love.
Mm-hmm.
God is but love, and so am I. My identity is love. So it's going to undo all dualism, and yet even the non-duality teachings have been around in ancient China and ancient India, and the course is nothing new in terms of non-dual teachings. It's quite practical at giving you a workbook lesson to unlearn the world, unlearn the ego. And that's, I think, for us that have taken the course, you know, it was the start, in many cases, a real authentic start of really unwinding the mind from this dualistic belief system. And then, if we talk about it in practical terms, you know, if you think about how the life of Francis seemed to go, or the parable of Francis, you know, you started coming to like week-long retreats, or I think Kangaroo Valley was like 10 days or 12 days, and eventually coming and immersing in the community. How would you describe that unlearning? Certainly the life that you had as whatever, an accountant or financial planner, or the life that you had in Sydney and before started to shift from what it seemed to be. It seemed to go through a metamorphosis, a big one.
Yeah, it's hard for me to describe what happened, or everything happened. I don't know. I can't describe any specifics anymore. But but that's what I talked about. You know, being here, practice those metaphysics and principles, and they're not intellectual concepts anymore. Like, let's talk about the concept so that we wake up through understanding. And that's not. It didn't work for me, and it's not really what has worked for me. So really, like, I feel coming here, the process, if I can really put in words, has been a kind of putting aside of a lot of the concepts and really just dive into, we're talking about undoing the world, but it's actually the process is through really going into it and without any denial or avoiding of whatever that is arising, like emotions and seeming thoughts and stories that just are very sticky in the mind. And you know, those are the process that are really going into it until they're not sticky anymore. And it's not like effort now, like, you know, okay, we know they're not right, they're not the teaching of the course, so we have to not do that. No, the natural result is that it's gone, it's disappeared, it's dissolved in the mind, and the mind started to open up to this vastness, and it's not really confined in any kind of identity or stories. So, yeah, I feel like every aspect of the community and of all these years of little practice and communication with friends here, and the focus on following the Holy Spirit, which wasn't something that that I actually just got from reading the book myself. I feel that was one of the elements that's very unique by coming here. That's the focus of the community, that is the focus of your teachings. And so, and that put everything into practice, that, you know, following the Spirit and talking about the concept becomes, you know, the way that, you know, coming here is the way that we follow the Spirit. And I guess, yeah, I can say that that has been just so amazingly helpful that I can't even imagine. Like, you know, right now I can say that following the Spirit in terms of guidance, in form, that stepping stone doesn't, it's not here anymore. The concept of guidance in form doesn't resonate anymore. And yet, whatever that I'm open up to right now, like just the experience of everything is involuntary, and just the mind is just completely let go of the screen and this true relaxation. And whatever that is happening right now, I would not be able to either experience or even envision before, you know, before taking those steps of really following the Spirit. And I kept saying that to you know, friends here and to myself, like really following the spirit is following that, find out this joy that is already there in the heart, and just know that it's always there. It has been in our heart, and just following that without compromise. But at the same time, it's such an undoing process in and of itself, because to be able to follow the spirit, something invisible, intangible, not logical, it really requires that we are willing to let go of anything that we, you know, self-concept or self-interest, preferences, personal views, will as I define it, like anything that we don't even see, those subtle concept that we use to define the self and hold the full self in place. And all of things, you know, we have to let go in order to follow the spirit. So that process, you know, I can see that what it did, but I know there are so many things that I don't even know that it did for me. You know, just the washing away has been just so amazing. And then it reached a place that you see, okay, that is not the truth either. And the truth is not anything that can be talked about or anything that can be used as a formula. It's just all that is helpful. And the mind, just like the last characteristic of the teacher of God, as in the manual for teachers in the course, saying the last characteristic is open-mindedness. And that is where those practice has, you know, lead me to this, like the mind is open and has been practicing just letting go of any kind of conclusion of anything. And then, as you said, I didn't learn anything, but I feel like everything that I thought I knew, you know, those I know kind of mind is not really there anymore. And just so open to not interpret and not conclude on anything, and willing to be in so much collaboration with the flow of life. Like there is no resistance at any level, you know, and there's like this deep peace, and whatever that's happening is a full yes. And then that is a space that the mind, the dualistic mind, does not tap into. It either goes into the low and depression or this mediocre space, or it goes to high of some kind of high, but there is a realm that is beyond both. And that's where this practice has led the mind into. And there is no way I can talk and I can foresee, you know, where this is the place that eventually we will reach by talking about the concept. Yeah. That's why that all these concepts and all these questions are the foundation for the mind to really actually tune into what is the answer from a course perspective, not from the ego perspective, and then laying the foundation, but transfer of training. That is what the course is pointing to. You know, people, whoever think the course is a dualistic teaching, they're caught up in words, because words are all dualistic, concepts are all dualistic. Anyone who really practice, use the words as a pointer to really practice, will know this is definitely a non-dualistic teaching, because that's where the mind is open up to.
Yeah. So that really is taking it into transfer of training, when you start to realize that none of the concepts are true or ever were.
Mm-hmm.
And then, so it's not so much trying to look for a change in form or even knowing what a change in behavior would be, because those are all part of concepts as well. This is a new perspective on the world.
Mm-hmm.
It's like you're just gazing upon the whole world, and I mean everything, not gazing through the body's eyes, but there's one who's watching the world that's beyond the body, beyond the five senses, and that watching, that new perspective on the world, is very glorious, very happy, very still, but it's not definable in earth terms or in worldly terms. And I think that's the thing that, you know, when you see conversations going on, there's just assumptions that are underneath those conversations about my mother, my father, my sister, my brother, my son, my daughter, my aunt, my uncle. It's my. It's a personality's relationship in a horizontal way and some kind of a concept there. Just to say I talk to my mother, you know, is there's a lot of concepts underneath that simple sentence, I talk to my mother or something. Because it's interesting because we were riding in the car the other day and you were describing this conversation that you'd had that was kind of going to how do you know where you're going to go next or whatever, and you say, well, I just feel it and
follow
the invitation. And then the voice at the other end of the phone said, I invite you. And then it's like, well, and being invited, you know, for the teaching, for the presence and everything like this. And then there was this, oh, okay, I see. There was this recognition. But it wasn't a mother talking to a daughter, because there is no mother and there is no daughter. And that's that vast experience where you're freed of all concepts.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's presence. It's just presence extending. And it's really not even a dialogue. It's a presence. But you see, that's really how deep this goes. That's what, when we talk about transfer training, you know, it's not saying, well, for years I went to the office and now I'm quitting my job, so I won't go to my office anymore. It's seeing that there is no office. And there never has been an office. You know, it's that deep of a transfer. The presence was never contained in time and space. It was never in persons. It was never even in avatars. You know, it's a lot of transfer of training when you start to see that your saints and your avatars and your enlightened beings and everything, that they were just symbols, and it never was in them either. It's not in anything. It's not in the world. And that's this. You can call it enlightenment or self-realization, but you're very relaxed, it's very peaceful, it's very still. It's not like you can choose whether you're going to take something personal or not. It doesn't register. There's no person to register with. There's no personal opinions. There's no personal perspective. You know, but that's just more concepts. And that's really where this is heading, not just to talk the talk, they say, but to walk the walk, and eventually what we mean by walk the walk is it goes so far beyond the body that it ceases to feel natural to try to define anything, because God is beyond definition and who we are is beyond definition. So you cease to have a need to define. And then you have no need to have an opinion, no need to make a point, no need to win anything, no need to prove anything. It's quite delightful, mm-hmm. when you're just in that relaxed state of beingness or presence. So that's our highest calling. You might say that a book has words and it seems to be a human being may seem to pick it up and read it or read a website. The same with the Course, but that could be seen as like a beginning point, but then where this goes, it has no end. It doesn't reach a point in time and space where you say, oh, I found this form or I arrived at that form. That doesn't make any sense at all. It's quite delightful. And then also there's so much stillness that, you know, there's so much contentment that there really is no need for words. If there's a spirit inspiring and they come in a very natural way, almost like pouring a glass of water, if it just pours out, then so be it. But there's no need for it. It's not something that you feel impelled or compelled to do. And we were talking recently where just the joy of this collaboration is there, but you were saying there's really nothing else. And so that kind of makes it even simpler too, because there's not a sense of biding time. There's no time, you know, to deal with it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So we're zooming through all 528 pages here. For us, you know, it's, I guess this is kind of like, it's almost like an afterthought, where it's, you know, it's different from how things seem to be in the world, where you know, you get a book, and if it's a big book, a thick book, you know, then this seems to involve a lot of reading. But, you know, this is more of a reflection that we can just kind of smile at it and look at it, and people joke about, you know, putting a book under their pillow or getting it through osmosis or this or this. This has just been a reflection of the presence that we feel. And in that sense, you know, there's a sense of, wow, if it has a helpfulness, anything that has a helpfulness in presence or to presence or from presence is good.
Yeah, it's where these words are coming from. It is so felt, you know, like, and that's like where the communication happens and message is delivered. Because I think just the last couple of days, I think I was trying to, I can't remember the context, whether to a friend or someone on the phone about something, and I explained in two ways, and these ways are completely contradictory, completely different, and I cannot reconcile at the level of words, but to me, where it comes from, it's exactly the same, but I can understand why they're completely, like, different, received differently, but I just really feel like, oh my god, it feels to me exactly the same, but I can't explain more. And that is where, you know, where the message is coming from is from a place of oneness, and it's from a place of no division and no, you know, separation. And that is, if you know, that message is coming from that place, you know, the words might be perceived as different, but the heart will not perceive the difference. It will receive the message, and that is what is really important. It's just not the words, not all these pages, but it's where it's coming from, you know.
Yeah. So that's really our focus, is it's our very life, this sense of presence. Because I know when it's still divided up in terms of the words, like when people say, don't talk about the future, don't talk about the past, or don't talk about this thing or that, or I let go of the story, and so on and so forth. The miracle is involuntary, and so it's the presence of love extending in whatever would be most helpful in any seeming circumstance will just come through. It could be a smile or a hug or a laugh or a pat on the back. You know, it doesn't even have to be verbal. It's just the presence of love is what everything is what it's all about. And therefore, the words that it's called, the Spirit will give you the words. In other words, the teacher of God does not select his or her words for him or herself. It's really, the words are given, are put there, if there are to be words. And if there aren't to be any words, then that's as well involuntary. But it's the presence is what it's all about. So then there's no sense of ever being right or wrong. There are no right or wrongs. There are no more positions to take. There are no more arguments, or there's nothing that needs to be pushed or gotten or manifested or anything. It's just quite joyful and relaxed because there's nothing in form that could ever change. You know, it's not about trying to make any kind of change in form, just beholding it with new eyes, you know, just realizing, you know, what it truly is, that it's not apart from consciousness, that everything is mind, everything is consciousness. So that's really what we're all about. That's what the whole community is about. It's not about growing anything, making anything, establishing anything. It's not trying to change the world. It's not trying to make the world a better place. It doesn't really involve any kind of self-improvement at all. It's just a state of mind that's literally beyond improvement. It transcends it. And that's been kind of, there's a number of movies, but the Transcendence movie seems to come in a lot for us because There's no fighting involved, it's just transcending. There's no challenge involved, it's just transcendence. It's just being aware that everything is completely connected and one. And then if words are given or something comes, there is no travelers in presence. There is no father, mother, sister, brother. You know, that was why it was kind of fun when you said you were having this conversation. It to the world might appear as a mother, daughter, but the presence couldn't be contained in such tiny concepts. And so, you know, it was like, oh, you know, I travel upon invitation. And, you know, it was all made very, very clear, but it was a presence extending. It wasn't a mother speaking to a daughter. And that's the vastness we're talking about. It's not that you still have roles, but you're in a state of mind where you don't have a role at all, and then the words are just given. But you don't even try to find the meaning in the words. It's still in the presence behind the words. So it's beautiful to hear about that. Yeah. So yeah, we're just having this experience, really, is what it's all about for us.
There are questions.
And there are some typed questions, two typed questions coming in. And so, Eric, you want to read?
I'll go ahead and read them. So we have a question that came in from Jane McGrady, but it's a question from Peter. He says, "Greetings. What does it mean to save the world if the world is synonymous with the ego and has to be unlearned? Thank you." And then the second question is from Jamie Velasque. "Is it common for someone to get a particular repetitive prompt that feels like they have to act on it or be stuck? That's what I'm experiencing, because I tend to procrastinate out of fear and say to spirit, this doesn't seem very gentle, but eventually do it.
Okay, those are our two questions for now. We'll take one and then the next. We'll take Peter's question.
Save the world.
Save the world. Yeah, save the world. Reminds me of that Michael Jackson song, "Heal the World, Make It a Better Place." Save the world. Well, certainly the spirit doesn't need to be saved. So, because oneness doesn't even have an idea what healing is or salvation. But save the world would have to apply towards a split mind. In other words, if the world is a projection of the split mind or of the ego, the belief in separation from God, then saving the world is very much the same as salvaging. But it goes beyond the metaphor of the world being the ego, because it's not like you can really save the ego either. If the ego is a puff of nothingness, a tiny man idea, you can't really save a puff of nothingness. You can't save an illusion. But in A Course in Miracles, Jesus clarifies it, and he says, only the mind can be saved or salvaged, he says, and it is only saved or salvaged through peace. So that one sentence has two parts to it, but it's extremely helpful at getting clear of what this saving thing is. Because a lot of times we've grown up in Christianity. I know, Peter, you grew up in Christianity over there in Europe, and I grew up in Christianity, seemingly in the parable of David. But we were talking about saving souls, as if people had souls, individual, private, little, separate souls, 6-7 billion of them around the planet, and that some of them were saved and some of them weren't. And you had better get out there and be a good Christian and save the lost souls so that they could know Jesus. But really, persons and souls, it's not what it's about either. It's about the mind that's split, or the mind that believes the ego is real, needing to come round right. You know, it 'tis a gift to be simple, 'tis a gift to be free, you know, And eventually, till by turning and turning, we come round right. Huh. We unwind the mind. Here we are again. We just keep following it, and turning by turning and turning, or unwinding and unwinding, we come round right, like the song, 'Tis a Gift to Be Simple. That's really what the saving's about. It's salvaging the mind, meaning it's coming back to holistic thinking. It's coming back to, we could say, right-mindedness, where you see that it's all right-minded, inspired by the Holy Spirit, and it's all connected and it's all unified. It's the happy dream, it's the real world. And that's the saving. So it's a good question, Peter, in the sense that we certainly know that the Spirit or God doesn't need to be saved, and the ego can't be saved either. How can you save something that doesn't exist? But it's this sense that if you have a split mind, you're trying to serve two masters. You know, the Bible says no man can serve two masters. And that which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. And it's a dilemma when you believe that there's both flesh and spirit, when there's actually only one, and that's spirit. And there never was flesh, and there never was separation, and there never was duality and struggle and so forth. So it always helped me to keep it simple, and I love that one simple line from Jesus, that only the mind is in need of salvation. Only the mind can be salvaged, and it is only salvaged through peace. It's not salvaged through saving the whales, through saving the ozone, through saving the sinners, you know, through saving the lost ones, the lost souls, or, you know, saving the planet, trying to save Mother Earth, or saving money, you know, or all the things that we talk about saving with, you know, all those things are really just distractions. But the mind that believes it's split, the mind that believes it can actually serve two masters, that mind is in need of salvation, because it's in need of peace. So that's what that means. And then the prompt. Have you ever had that situation that was being described in the second question, where you had a prompt, and the prompt, and the prompt kept coming, and you had a feeling of stuckness, but you felt, wow, I think I need to follow that prompt?
Yeah, definitely had a lot of those experiences, and I feel like the Holy Spirit has been really gentle with me and never really threw anything that I couldn't handle at me. But there were times where I felt it was a big leap, almost like leap into the unknown, and there was a lot of fear. And in those moments, I actually remember in one of those times, like, you came to my dream. You were so gentle with me, but in my dream, you were like, don't waste time anymore, so firm. And I woke up, like, and then I thought, okay, I can take this message, because it was in a dream. It wasn't really that harsh. But it got my attention. It was like, okay, don't waste time anymore. Just, you know, because when, you know, I know that was the prompt. There was no doubt. The fear level was very high, but I knew at the point that this was what I was supposed to do. So, yeah, for me, I was just wanting to pray. Like, in those moments, I remember once I just prayed, like, please just carry me through this. I don't know how I was going to do that, but just carry me through it. And you want me to build up faith with you, so just, you know, carry me through this, and just make every single step very, very obvious, so that I don't have to, you know, think I can make a mistake or I can make a wrong step. Just make it very obvious, and I will just be here upon your request, you know, just move along. And he really did carry me, you know, so to speak,
mm-hmm.
in, you know, one or two of those worst moments. And so, yeah.
So just, I would say in summary too, with to your question, it is quite common, especially as you start to really give yourself over to the Spirit and you start to say, use me, open my heart, heal my mind, take me back to you, back to God. As you open, and that's the prayer of your heart, and you've been used to being kind of in that stuck feeling, or maybe a depressed feeling, or maybe feeling lack of energy, or like you know, you're trapped in some way. Very common experience as far as for human beings. And then you open your heart to Christ, you open your heart to Spirit, and you start to get these prompts, and then you feel like it's repeated, like it's come, you need to do this now. And you have a feeling that by not following those prompts, you're just spinning your wheels, you're stuck in quicksand, you're still trapped. The stuckness is associated with not following those prompts. And what's happening is that the Spirit is calling you and the Spirit is prompting you, and yet, you know, there's a fear of awakening. It's not even a fear of the means or what will happen if you follow those specific prompts, but it's where it's heading. You know, if I keep following the Spirit, what if I am a nobody and a nothing? What if I disappear? What if I cease to exist as a separate human being, a separate individual? That part is terrifying to the ego. So the ego doesn't want you to follow those prompts. And this is common, I know for myself, for Francis, we've worked with many, many people to get out of the lethargy, to get out of the stuckness, the pattern. You have to pay attention to these prompts. And I do remember, like from the parable of David, even back in graduate school, before I was even into the course, I was getting prompts to move to transfer to another program, and yet I had all the shoulds and shouldn'ts in my mind, and who I would disappoint if I would transfer, disappointing parents and professors and all these people I would let down, and all the guilt I would feel if I disappointed them and this and that. And yet I kept getting prompts over and over and over: leave, transfer. And then I kept pushing them down, stuffing them back down, ignoring them, and eventually got quite sick, quite ill from stuffing all these prompts down. And then it became obvious I actually had to follow the prompt. And then when I did, I felt, oh, like tons of bricks, weights were lifted off of me. I still had to face reactions and people's looks and glances and glares and everything. But after I'd followed the prompt, it felt I could handle anything. It was just, I needed to move forward. And I think these prompts, you know, as you talk to people in our community, can seem to be what the world would call major things: leaving behind jobs or children or different situations that the world would say, you're in that one for life. You know, it's already got you prescribed of how you're supposed to live the rest of your life. And then you start to get in these prompts of, it's really loosening your mind and unwinding your mind and unlearning the world and seeing that you're not a person, you're not a body, you're actually the Spirit, and you've always been the Spirit, you are the living Christ. But that unwinding involves a lot of prompts, and to the extent that you just stuff them back down and try to play religion or play the roles and live out, continue wearing the mask and continue the roles, when really that's not your heart's joy. Like, you could look at right now in your life, you know, it's, you seemed to have let go of concepts, but there's no harm. It's, yeah, it's quite joyful.
Yeah. I mean, following the prompts, I mean, when we know the prompts, a lot of the times we have a certain kind of spark or resonance with the direction it's going, and the fear, the inspiration is there, and the fear level is high. And I know that in my personal experience, you know, when the fear was really high, we don't really recommend that you push through it or anything. But I have to say, when you know that's the prompt and the fear level is high, the reward is equally high, because the fear was almost like the ego, you know, that movie Oblivion, and they say hazard zone, don't go there, because you're gonna lose or you're gonna experience something really fatal. But that is the ego's trick of, don't go there, because there's some kind of big undoing of the ego that's gonna happening in the mind. A big opening is there, and by following that, you know, the mind will open up and the undoing will happen, and the ego will lose its control, and the reward is amazing. I just know that I lost my train of thought, but I just wanted, yeah, that's my personal experience. I just remember, you know, some of the specific fear that I thought it was the fear of my lifetime that I come here to work through. And when I really faced that head on, when it was time, when I was ready and really worked through that, you know, the freedom of seeing that fear is not true, the freedom of seeing there is no fear, that is the reward.
Yeah. And if you just know that if you keep following those prompts, you'll just be carried into an experience, this vast experience, which is really forget this world, forget this course, and come with open arms unto your God. It's this unification experience. We were talking the other day when we were out driving about this crazy idea of what is yours and what is mine, or what is yours and what is the church's, or it could take any form, as if there's a two-ness there.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, the deeper you go, when you have this experience, you all sense of two-ness, all sense of opposites disappear. And you can say that your experience of the world is completely different than it was when you were trying to hold on to the two-ness. Because then you always are like, what is mine, what is yours?
Mm.
Did I say too much? Did I say too little? Did I do enough? Mm. Did I do too much? Did I do too little? You know, it's always gyrating and spinning when there's a sense of opposites and two-ness, and when there's this beautiful unification experience, which is naturally your natural state of mind, then it's very restful because you don't even concern yourself. Those aren't even questions, you know. What's the marital status of the number five? You know, it doesn't have a marital status. And you start to realize that that kind of feeling applies to everything in the world. So you don't try to figure things out anymore because you realize there's nothing there to figure out. So yeah, it's worth following those prompts. Like you say, the reward is, as much as it seems to be fear, you can know that there is the reward of that peace when you actually follow it. It's
the reward is almost instant. Like it's like experience simultaneously as you move through that, the mind is opening up and this amazing mystical or peaceful realm that is there waiting, that's very, very open, and you know, like this heart opening. I mean, yeah, it can even sounds paradoxical, but it is in my experience. You know, as I was moving through fear, I was going through the heart opening at the same time, and it can be felt. It's really profound.
Yeah. Okay, well, maybe we can open it up. Is there anybody in the studio audiences that have anything to share, a comment or a question or anything? And yes.
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 Okay. This is calling, and I've been kind of trying really hard to kind of forgive and try to release judgments those couple of days, and I really kind of found some difficulties to do so. It's like even if I'm in community, I'm in here, I still need to kind of really step into forgiving, really kind of release judgments to, like David said, practice releasing judgments and the perception will change. So it's like, I really kind of need to forgive or release judgments from everything, because it's like everything is kind of hard, kind of, it's like I don't like it or I don't accept it. It's like quite overwhelming. So my question is, how do I really do that, really forgive, and how do I really find that kind of point, that determination, or that the determination that I want to forgive no matter what the matter, how the environment is.
Okay, very good. If you want to mute it, we'll talk to that. Well, let's talk a little bit about forgiveness, because as long as we hold forgiveness in the realm of personhood, which is the realm of doing things, I have to forgive. Or I'm at the community now. I've come all the way from China and I've finally made it, and now pressure's on. I've got to forgive. More so now than ever, because I'm now around a bunch of other people that are practicing forgiving, and if they're forgiving and I'm not forgiving, then that's not good. But there's a pressure of got to forgive. I've got to forgive. It's no different as almost if you were a piano protege, you know, and you were expected to give a great concert, you know, and really perform, or Eric's here with us. He was known in the community as this great singer, songwriter, and everything. And we finally have our Strawberry Field, and he gets up there and he meditates, as the people in the audience are, you know, going, "Come on, sing something," and this, you know, it. As long as there's a pressure to do anything, or even a pressure to forgive, it's almost like it's seen as some kind of an action, or maybe even a personal mental action, like I, Colin Deng, have to forgive, and that's why I'm here, and the pressure's on, because if I don't, well, then what could happen? Will I get kicked out, or will I fall behind, or, you know, I'll just be more different than everybody if everybody's forgiving and I'm not. It's this idea of even seeing forgiveness in a personal way that puts the pressure on, it brings the pressure on. And actually, when you really look at what forgiveness is, you forgive your brother for what he did not do, you can forgive the Colin character for what he did not do, and then even beyond the doing, we'll call it the thinking. Like if you say, "Well, I have fear thoughts, or I have doubt thoughts, or I have judgments," who is the I that has those fear thoughts and doubt thoughts and judgments? It's still this person. It's still seen in a very personal way. And that's where the pressure is coming on. And I remember when I first met you, you know, you came to hear me speak. Francis was there, I think. Was it Jason the very first time too, our very first visit there, and following us to Kentucky Fried Chicken, didn't we go to Kentucky Fried Chicken there in Beijing, and we went there and we said, "Come to lunch with us," and so you did, and you came, and it was more that you just felt all this love, because we have so much love that it radiates out to everything and everyone, and we were like, "Come along, walk with us, come have lunch with us." And somehow in that beautiful, beautiful, vast love, you felt that you didn't have to hold the mask up anymore. I remember you cried and your head went down to the table and the snot was pouring out all over the table, but it didn't matter, because you were loved. You could seem to be however you were. The behaviors could be anything, and you were just loved, and we just stayed there with you, and even in other visits, you know. And that's what I've felt when you write me emails. I feel that you feel this love that's emanating from us, and this love is really a state of mind that doesn't need to have anything in form change or anything be corrected, because this love is not a personal love, and it's not, it doesn't make any judgment of the forms, regardless of what the forms are. You might say there's absolutely no pressure in this love, because there's no sense that things need to be a certain way and form. It's a perspective and looking on the world, a forgiven perspective that just lets this love radiate through. So, you know, it's the sense that when you say, I have doubt thoughts, or I have judgments, or I can't release them, or I can't forgive them, that it's just holding on to like this self-concept. And when you really truly feel the presence of love, it's not like there's no pressure being put on. It's more of a, I am accepted just as I am. I am loved exactly as I am. And to just receive that love, knowing you can't mess it up. You can't think or say or do anything that would change that love. That love is always there. It will always be there. It's just like embracing you and holding you. And so all you're really doing is you're opening your heart to that love. And when you start to think of forgiveness, and you're thinking of it in past terms, like when you would study for an exam, you had to study. That was an activity, study. Or when you had to go to school or get a job or perform something, kind of a task in the family or something like this. Those are all doings, like active doings. And now you're being asked to just open up, to go beyond that sense of a doer. Doing things right or wrong, you know, it's two sides to the same coin. You can have a false sense of pride about accomplishments and what you've done right, and how you've pleased your parents or pleased friends and so on and so forth. And then there's the negative, I've let these people down, or I'm this way, I'm not worthy, I will never make it, and I won't be able to forgive. You know, they're just two sides of the illusory coins of the world. And what we want you to feel more than anything is just that complete love and acceptance. And I know that that's, you know, we felt that when we were down, we met your family and had lunch with your father and yourself, and we got to meet your family. You know, it was just the love in our hearts extending to you. And at the end of one of our talks, I remember your family came up, and they came right up to Francis, and they said, you know, Colin's going through these intense emotions, and all these behaviors that are coming, and intense things, and I just was there long enough to hear Francis' response to your family, saying, oh, that's normal when you study the Course. And their look on their faces, like, normal? My gosh, there's intense emotions, but she was describing how there was a love, there was an allowance to get in touch with all that. And that's so important in healing. Even though the ego is tempted to try to make something of it and judge, it was just, I thought it was beautiful just watching that exchange that you had. It was so loving. She was just being so true from the heart. Just like, oh, that's what happens when you devote yourself, you know, deeply to the Course and to healing. So the main thing I want to tell you is that, you know, if you're not doing anything right or wrong, and even mentally, when you seem to experience those thoughts passing through, they're just thoughts passing through. You don't have to identify and say, these are my judgments, these are my doubt thoughts, because in the end, you know, the only way that we forgive is to have an experience that we could never have judged in the first place. That was never us. You know, that we aren't egos. We never were the ego. We identified with it, and that's what brought the guilt. And when you start to loosen, just let those thoughts be like passing clouds. Let them go by. What do we got today? Oh, let's watch the parade. Let them go by. Watch those thoughts, but don't draw a conclusion that is truly who you are, or that those are your real thoughts, because those aren't the thoughts you think with God. Anything else coming for you? She's just beaming at you. Yeah, we love you, Colin. There he is. We see you. And he's prompting him. And that's the rest of the story.
That's the rest of the story.
Yeah, I'll see you soon. I'll see you in, is it a couple weeks or so? I'll be down to Mexico, La Casa de Milagros. I can give you a big, long hug. Yeah, I think we can mute it again. I'll share. It's, yeah, forgiveness is really, it's just a state of mind. And so it's funny that when you are identified with the ego, you think about that you have to do some kind of action to get into this state of mind. But you already are this state of mind. And this is the whole thing of like a cat chasing his tail, or many non-dual teachers have talked about, you know, you can never experience enlightenment while you still conceptualize it. Because when it's conceptualized, it's always an action. It always involves a doing. It always involves the future. And none of that is it. It's just presence is always present. It doesn't involve something that eventually happens in the future. It's part of the trick. So it's like the cat chasing its tail, you know, and never seeming to quite get there. And so, you know, maybe like you, Colin, like many people have lived in families, wanted, you know, to be happy and to be free, and you were dealing with these creatures called parents and siblings, and then you've got these professor creatures, and you know, it's quite a place to try to navigate time and space with all these creatures. creatures from the Black Lagoon, you know, they're all over the place, and how are you ever going to be happy with all these creatures? It's like a monster movie. Well, actually, you have to start to realize that you don't need to please them, and neither do you have a person to please, that it's possible to drop it. It's possible to drop the whole game. It's possible to drop the whole mask. But the mask isn't a personal mask. It's, as Jesus tells us, it's the whole world that you see. The stars are part of that mask. You know, if you look with telescopes at the different galaxies and with electronic powerful, you know, telescopes, or if you look at microscopes and you look at the particles, the molecules, you go smaller and smaller. All of that is part of the mask. It's an atomic mask. It's a molecular mask. It's a cellular mask. It's a human creature mask. It's a mask that has mountains in it. It has oceans, and it even has clouds. And it's a mask that has stars. It's the whole world, the whole cosmos is like a cosmic mask. And I always talk about the Bible, Adam and Eve, and you know, and they knew they were naked, and then they started to try to find fig leaves to cover up their private parts. It's like the cosmic fig leaf. This whole time-space cosmos is like a cosmic fig leaf that the mind feels guilty and wants to cover itself with. And then if you just relax, you start to realize that you're really none of it. You know, you could say you're none of it, you could say you're all of it, if from an inclusive perception of everything, but not all of it in a linear way. It's just all simultaneous. And all you're doing is practicing opening your heart and allowing yourself to feel that love that's always been there, because it's who you are, it's who I am, it's who we are as God created us. And if there's one thing I could leave you with, is just relax and don't, you know, treat forgiveness like another kind of linear curriculum, you know, like learning, studying for a test, or don't think of forgiveness as like an achievement that somehow you have to do and achieve. It's you have to softly unwind, you have to be gentle, you have to let these attachments and these old concepts and old beliefs just be lifted from your mind gently, and feel that love radiating and growing stronger and stronger. But it's the reason forgiveness is such a struggle for you, Colin, is it's just that you're holding it really in a very, still in a very strong conceptual way. That's what we've all done, and so it, you know, that's what's been the challenge. But like Francis was sharing earlier in the broadcast, it's like, it's the sense of not holding on to any concepts and seeing how wonderful you feel when you're emptied from those concepts. Even the subtle ones, you were talking about how even in spirituality or community, there can be very subtle concepts that still are not real. But if you give, even if you give weight to them, if you give reality to them, even identifying with doubt thoughts, you know, and saying, I have doubt thoughts, you know, you're taking your I am-ness and you're grasping onto these fleeting, passing thoughts, and you're saying, I have doubt thoughts, and that's not it either. You know, you have to be much softer and even much more gentle, you know, to go past that. So we're there with you, you know, we're really with you every single instant. We're there with you in this moment and every instant, you know, just calling to you to just let go of those thoughts. Don't conclude anything. Be willing to be a passerby. Let those go by.
Even that conclusion, even that thought, I don't like this person, I need to forgive, I don't like that person, that's a conclusion. Like, to be honest, we don't really know what's going on. We don't really know. There is some kind of feeling, or there's some kind of force, or they're probably like not really the guidance to spend a lot of time, or in that very moment, you know, just like allow that conclusion to be withdrawn, and then see, really allow what is to show us the reality. You know, we're not here to tell ourselves, I don't like this person, but it could be just as simple as that. You know, in that moment, there is no guidance, or is not in the script to have interaction, you know, really, and then allow this emotion to come up without any kind of conclusion, just washes all this conclusion away, and then new interpretation gradually will come to the mind, and you realize, you know, forgiveness is this letting go of conclusions, and in the end, you're innocent, and there's nothing to forgive, is, you know, as a result of all this letting go of the conclusions.
And I know that email you wrote to me today, Colin, you talked about how there's this kind of authority problem that's in there, and it's easy to get projected out to characters that are in the dream, and it's easy to project it out, you know, to the Colin character, like feeling like, oh, I'm not fitting in, or I don't want to, I'm a person that doesn't want to do this, and this, but, so you feel guilty, or then you flip it out and you can feel more like the rebel, like, well, I'm a decent person, but these people around me, they're controlling me, they're trying to change me, trying to fix me. You see, those are the two angles, but you mentioned in your email that then the other option is to forgive, but loosen from what that forgiveness must look like, or that it's some kind of an action, where it's just this soft, gentle watching, like forgiveness is quiet and does nothing. It looks and waits and watches and judges not. I love that line from the Course. You know, that it looks and waits and watches and judges not. It's a beautiful sentence of what forgiveness is. It doesn't really say do in there. Looks and waits and watches and judges not. It doesn't even mention like an action, like da 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 da, I forgave, put the crown on my head or do something because I did it. You know, it's not like holding up the trophy at Wimbledon or at the end of a race being the winner. There's no personal component to forgiveness, and it's so soft and gentle, but it's just a way of beholding the world, gazing upon the world in a very holistic way, and you're just there allowing those emotions to come up, and sometimes being tempted to act on them, sometimes not acting on them. Either way, you just have to watch. You just have to be a good watcher, you know, because it's as long as you're identified with doing or not doing or complying and saying yes, oh steward, overseer, yes, I will do this, and then the other part's going no, not now, no, I don't want to do that, but I'll do it, I want to conform. It's the authority problem. It just is held on to when there's a sense of conforming or rebelling. Those are just more thoughts that are just passing by, and there's really no solution in that, and if you still go there, you know, that's where the frustration comes in. But if you just step back and say, no, I like that Buddhist chant, I think it was, I know nothing. Just say that a few hundred times before you go to bed tonight. You know, you can just lay there and, I know nothing. It's very relaxing. You say that enough. Because it's actually true. That's why it's so relaxing. Yeah. Something in the heart that's like, oh gosh, that's wonderful. Yeah. Okay, is there any more typed in things, or there's one more question?
Maybe one more typed in question from Chris with a C, and she says, what happens if you don't follow the prompt? Is it possible to take the wrong road?
What happens if you don't follow the prompt? Well, people ask me about pain and suffering and discomfort, and pain is only introduced to bring about like a contrast or an impetus for choosing again. So it's not anything that's absolutely essential to the curriculum of forgiveness, but when you don't follow the prompt, or you repeatedly don't follow the prompt, you know, that's why I shared that parable of the parable of David, where I got more than psychological discomfort. I started to have physical symptoms by just stuffing the prompt down over and over and over. And so The ego will interpret this as punishment. I mean, the ego takes pain and it takes punishment and it goes, ha ha, there's a connection here. That pain is God punishing you. And you see how that fits into that old mentality of sin. Like, that sin is like almost like a black mark. It's trying to turn your back on God. And, the Bible says the wages of sin is death. But actually, when there's discomfort that starts to be introduced into the mind, into awareness, it's just an impetus to choose again. And then as you become more of a happy learner, we'll say, or willingly choose to align with those prompts and those guidances, you actually have an experience that the pain was never there at all. And the suffering was never there. It was a total hallucination. It was just a total fabrication. It was really fiction. It was the fiction of pain. It was just the ego generating something and trying to maintain and guard itself. But when you expose the ego and you follow the prompts, then you start to realize that it was never there. It never, it could not ever been something that needed to be punished. That's just a false ego dynamic, that sin or error must be punished. And the spirit doesn't even know punishment. The spirit's just like this light that just shines and shines and calls the mind to return and calls the mind higher and higher into that awareness, but it's not even a concept that the spirit knows about. So, you know, there's always an incentive, a growing incentive, to just follow the guidance and follow the prompts. And I know that there actually have been Course in Miracles teachers that say, well, you know, you can't really hear the Holy Spirit and you can't really follow the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will not direct you specifically and all these kind of things. But that was really not my experience at all as I was going through it. I was receiving guidance and specific guidance and so forth. And then it gets more like to what Francis is talking about, where that starts to, you just start to transcend even that goes away too. But we don't want to just push that and say, no, that'll never happen. Because, you know, the spirit can use the symbols that you believe in. And if you believe in words and instructions, then the Holy Spirit can reach you in that way.
Yeah, I feel like following the prompts, you know, if there's a single answer to say whether there are any consequences in form, whether you can make a wrong turn, no, because the script is written and it is, you can't make a wrong turn, so to speak. But what we were talking about is the direction in the mind. You know, when you follow the prompt, and it's not a step to be missed. So that's why sometimes it's really not helpful to jump to the concept and then to talk it through. It has to be followed through, and following the prompt is a significant step in the mind. Like, the thinking of it is to start to relinquish I know, to eventually this realization that my will and the spirit's will are one, or spirit knows what I want, you know, and that is a significant step in the mind. It's almost like Jesus has this three teachings in the course, and saying, you know, the first, simply do this, and there are three lessons. The first one is to have, give all to all. And does he say in form give all to all? I don't know, because in form, eventually it's all written. But this step of the mind, and he said, is a direction that is to be made. It's crucial. And he said, this has to be made by yourself, is this change of the direction of the thinking. And whether you have given how many millions of dollars in the past, if this moment the direction of the thinking is not giving, then there's no peace right now. And it doesn't really matter. So in terms of following the spirit, we still talk, you know, even though that stepping stone has been transcended, so to speak, it is still being talked about a lot, because ultimately it is a direction in the mind. We want to always think along with the whole and letting go of the self that think it knows, and we want to align our thinking to the direction of giving in every moment. So I would say it is important.
Yeah. And this book is really good for that, because I know I've had many, many talks with many people and many students over the years. I remember many years ago that Spike Lee made a movie, Do the Right Thing. And so, Do the Right Thing, it's really Think the Right Thing, because, you know, this book will actually help you. If you really go through this whole book, I have so many interactions with students, and they're really concerned about Do the Right Thing, you know. Do the right thing in my relationship, do the right thing with my children, do the right thing with my career, do the right thing with this person I met on the street or someone in my course group. It starts off with the students presenting their problems in the behavioral sense, because that's where they are perceiving the problems. They don't really know that they have a perceptual problem, that they're seeing a world that's not even there, that they're hallucinating, you know, that they've already had a psychotic break. They think they're normal, they have a normal family, normal kids, normal job, normal career. No, psychotic and schizophrenic. They're listening to two voices. They've had a complete break from reality, and that's the human condition. It's not just the students that happened. I just didn't get the psychotic and schizophrenic one. The whole human race is psychotic and schizophrenic. This isn't going to make it on Dr. Phil, but I will never have the popularity of Dr. Phil, but I never did want that either. So what this book does is it gently takes the presenting problems and it brings it back to right mind, wrong mind. Again, just a metaphor, the present moment, the more you go deep into the present moment, or what I would call right-mindedness, you do see that that's all that there is. It's everything is only present. And there is no past or future. But this is a practical unwinding from the presenting problems back to the decision in the mind. And so when you're talking about follow a prompt, the question isn't so much about the action. Do I do this or that? It's what is the purpose of my actions? What is it for? Now that is an important distinction, to let the Holy Spirit work with you on what is it for. Because the Holy Spirit is always working with you on what is it for. Regardless if you get prompts to give money or help somebody out or marry somebody, divorce somebody, date somebody, break up with somebody, you know, buy this, sell this, give this away. Those are all form things. It's the purpose underneath that's important, and that's the value of Unwind Your Mind Back to God. It's a practical manual. It's actually a testimony and a witness of watching how it's done. So I'm doing it with these students over the course of so many years, starting back in the 1990s, and you can benefit from watching it done with them, because I guarantee you this will relate to what you're going through too. You'll start to see that, you might even see striking parallels between the examples and the metaphors that are in the book, and that was the process. And so really it's the Spirit gently being with you, and this is like your owner's manual to what's really going on. The Spirit is not so concerned about this form or that form, because the Spirit knows that all the forms are the same. How could the Spirit be concerned? You know, you think, oh, I didn't pay this person back, or I was angry at this person, or even something more extreme, you know, I've had people that have shot somebody or killed somebody or whatever, and they're racked with guilt about this memory of the form that they think is unforgivable, that they just got to suffer with for the rest of their life. This is bringing it back to that purpose. And then it gives you a new purpose, a new way of looking at the whole world, the Holy Spirit's way of looking at the world. That's where the innocence is, but it's never do the right thing. It's be inspired by the Spirit, and what you do comes from what you think. What you do comes from what you feel. If you're inspired, if you're joyful, peaceful, happy, your behaviors will automatically flow from that state of mind. And if you're angry and jealous and envious, the behaviors will flow. The words, the facial expressions, the behaviors, the actions will flow from that. So it's really taking you back into consciousness and saying, let's look at the two purposes in there, the ego's purpose and the Holy Spirit's purpose. And the more you look at that, the more you realize that you really don't want what the ego's selling. You don't want its purpose, because it's just purely death. And no matter how you dress it up, and no matter how attractive you ingeniously make it look, in the end, you don't get fooled by the form anymore. It's like, oh, a death wish is a death wish is a death wish. I have no need of that. I do not want that. I would choose forgiveness instead. And this is your role modeling. This is your characters acting it out with their questions and the answers that come through the Spirit, through the mouth of David, or, you know, that are written down in here. This is just role modeling. Unwind your mind, bring it back, trace it back. That's one of my favorite songs, Carole King, Only Love Is Real, Everything Else Illusion. And the line that I like so much about that in that song is, tracing a line till we can define the thing that allows us to feel only love is real. Classic Carole King. You know, it's all right there. The whole Course in Miracles is in that song. So you don't, you know, if you really get that, you don't even need this book. You know, save your eyes some reading here. Spirit doesn't read. Okay, I see we have no more questions. We can open it up to our studio audience. Live from Camas, or from Mexico, or from the monastery. You're on the air. It's a silent mystics. That's what happens when you do this live streaming.
Oh, Chris. Yeah. Okay. What about a song?
A song from Eric? Nice. Well, everyone is in such a receptive, still mode here.
Sure. Just put it on the music setting here.
Oh, cool. Cool hangout music setting.
All prepared.
I like it.
Do you want it?
Oh,
yeah,
that's kind of the best. We can see Eric. We can see your knee. Your knee is participating. Your knee can bob along with the song.
Just relax and go slow. There's no need to hurry, for there are no monsters chasing you. Just be still and let go. There's no need to worry, and there's nothing that you really need to do. Take time to look inside, for I can promise you there's nothing about yourself you need to hide. Take off the mask and let the light shine on your innocent face. You've never done anything wrong. And there's nothing scary to protect yourself from. Your nightmares are over. You don't need to run. Just open your eyes and see there's nothing to fear. All of your nightmares have long disappeared. It seems a long time ago that you dreamed you'd left home and wandered outside in the cold all alone. You tried to make do with all your substitutes, but they could not erase the pain of forgetting the truth. Well, it's still in your heart, and it's still in your soul. Just take off your heavy armor and let it go. And listen to me while I sing you this song. Your friends are all here and your nightmares are gone. Nightmares are over, you don't need to run. When you open your eyes, you'll see there's nothing to fear. All of your nightmares have long disappeared. Just relax and go slow. There's no need to worry, and there are no monsters chasing you. Right here and right now, you can be at peace. Only love is all around.
It's delicious. Thank you, Eric.
Thank you. Thank you.
That's good. I like some of the questions, because tonight we've started to get at very, very core things, like, you know, like in philosophy, there's this debate for many, many, many centuries of free will versus determinism, but it's a state of mind. In spirit, our will and God's will is the same. So it's not, you know, thy will but not my will be done. It's thy will is my will in spirit. And there is no will really in form. Persons don't have will. It's talked about as if he had a strong will, she had a strong will, my cat had a strong will, that chameleon, that salamander had a strong will. There is no will in time and space. So you don't have this free will versus determinism thing. Free will is true in heaven, and that's reality. So that's saying a lot right there, even though it's beyond the words. And determinism, when we say the script is written, nothing happens by accident. There's no chance. There's no good fortune, bad fortune. It's all scripted, meaning it's all the past. Down to the most minute detail, it's all scripted. Now, even that's just a linear metaphor, because simultaneously there's not even a script, so I have to use some of these metaphors. But if we're talking about the script as written, it's all already there. Everything in the past is the past. That's what lesson number 7 is. I see only the past. Why? Because number 8, my mind is preoccupied with past thoughts. So what we're talking about, when you ask these beautiful questions like, you know, what if I, is there a consequence to not following the prompt? There is an emotional consequence. There is a psychological consequence. If the prompt is coming from the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit is your inspiration, your remembrance of joy and happiness and love and freedom, to not follow that voice, that prompting, that inner voice, that guide that's guiding you home, seems to have a consequence, emotional consequence. We call it fear and the many derivatives of it. Not in reality, because again, everything is the present moment, and if you come into the presence of the present moment, there is no fear. There never was. You know, it's the linear hallucination is gone. And so that's what we're talking about. That's how these seeming dichotomies that are talked about, sure, they're talked about in philosophy, they're talked about from people throughout the centuries, and even in your course group or your spiritual community, you might have these things of, can I make a mistake in form? No, you can't. You can't. The ego would have you believe that mistakes are in form. But there is no form apart from your mind. Everything is mind. Everything is consciousness. And there's nothing apart from mind. There are no projected forms that are apart from mind. That's why in the end, there really is no projection happening here either. That's just a device we used to talk about, trying to get rid of something you don't want. But when you come to total acceptance of the atonement, there is nothing that you don't want. And then you start to realize it's all mind. So when we ask the questions and we say, you know, can I make a mistake in form? There is no form apart from mind. Remember, my thoughts are images I have made. They're still thoughts. It's still mind. Ideas leave not their source. Thoughts don't leave the mind. They don't get manifested in something called form. You can't really make a mistake in form. Isn't that wonderful? Don't you? I mean, can you feel the weight of guilt? Colin, are you listening to me? You can't. You can't mess it up. You can't really make a mistake in form. Now, the ego will tell you you can, of course, because it made up the whole concept of form as if it had a behavior has autonomy and form has autonomy. The whole cosmos has autonomy. It's all mind. And so metaphorically, if you choose the ego, if you choose the imposter, if you choose the error, psychologically, you experience fear or a derivative thereof. And I'm going to take it one more step, because most people talk about fear and pain, guilt, envy, jealousy, and everything. Pleasure is fear too. Jesus says you can't tell the difference between fear and joy, because that's the pleasure factor coming in there. Pleasure gets associated with joy, but pleasure isn't joy. Pleasure is fear. So if you're devoting your life to hedonism, I tell you, it's not going to work. Devote it to meditation instead, sinking beneath all of these distorted miracle impulses and sinking way down to the stillness. Because really, the consequence, you'll know psychologically by how you feel whether you're following the ego or not. And the more consistently joyful you feel, the more you'll know that you're becoming consistently a follower of the Holy Spirit's guidance and prompts. And remember, those are in the mind, so we're not trying to judge the form of this prompt versus that prompt, this action versus that action, doing versus not doing. People, the mind, when it's asleep, it always tries to get out of the doing problem, the body identification, by doing or not doing. And that's not going to get you out. Those are still, you know, body identifications. The spirit is not a doer, it's a being, it's a spiritual being. So I'm glad you are raising these questions, because if you can just hear what I'm saying, that you've never made a mistake in form. The ego just took the mistake of separation and it projected it out to good behaviors, bad behaviors. In the end, they're all the same, because behaviors are behaviors, and spirit is spirit, and that which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the spirit is spirit. So you can see this, where the spiritual transformation is occurring, is becoming spirit identified and pulling your identification away from the form, because you'll never find identity in form. God knows not form. It's a beautiful sentence from the Beyond Our Idols section in the Course. Isn't that wonderful? You've never made a mistake in form, ever?
Will never.
And will never. Because that's, again, that's part of the trick. The ego wants you to believe that you have, so that then you can feel guilty. And it always is counting the good versus the bad. Almost like there's something going on psychologically in your soul somehow, that you go through life in a linear way of time and space, which isn't life at all. And you do good things and you do bad things, and you hope you've got a bigger stack of good things than bad when you reach the pearly gates and you have to face the day of judgment. What a bunch of bunk. That's a total setup. It's none of it's true. It has nothing to do with reality. Basically, you're choosing in this moment, right mind, wrong mind, and you're practicing more and more of your yes God, right mind, and the more consistent you get with that, then the other, seeming other, just fades away, and it melts, like the Wicked Witch of the West melts when there's a bucket of water thrown on her. It's not a big struggle, big battle going on, just a bucket of water. The Holy Spirit, you know, just dissolves away the idea of wickedness. There's no wickedness in love. I think it's all really simple, really. I don't understand the complexity. This is really simple. This is basic. And if you really feel it's ingrained and you're really wound into a very complex, twisted, dark thought system,
I've
got a book for you.
Yeah.
And if you don't like paper, then go to Teacher's website and you can read some and listen some. And if you don't like to read at all, then we have Spreaker. You can just put your ears to work. You can listen. And if you're tired of words altogether, you don't want to hear them or read them, go to YouTube. Turn the volume down. Just watch a lot of smiley faces, peaceful, calm foreheads, and lots of smiling faces, laughter. You know how it looks. You don't even have to hear the sound. You can turn the sound down. And if that's too much to you, then just close your eyes and meditate. Spirit's got a way.
We've got a comment from Karen Moore Klein. She wrote, "The book is awesome! Exclamation point. Love the first part about form versus content." And she has a question. "If you're living in content, is it more about living in your abstract mind 24/7? And specifics are there, but they are just part of the flow?" That's
her question. Okay, that's a good one too. Yeah, the specifics are, the mind is, we could say, into selective perception. So the more you attune to the miracle, which literally lifts your mind up to the celestial realm, then the specifics start to fade away and become less and less significant and less important and more just given. I think that's a word we use a lot. It's almost like this community's got their own language, you know. We're going to have a little, what do they call that, where they have the thesaurus and of terms and what it all means.
We don't realize it because we talk about it so much. Then when we
think everybody talks that
we
way.
When we do a retreat, someone they say, you know, you guys talk about joining. What does that even mean? Joining. You guys always talk about joining. Join. Can we join? Like something that we talk so much, we don't even see this.
Or we'll just be smiling like each other. Oh, it's given. That's given. And everyone's like, "What's given? What's that even mean?" But given is that involuntary nature. Like if the specifics are all just, you know, everything's just showing up, and you're not trying to dissect things and figure things out and so forth. And you're just being present with what's given. Like it's, you know, you could say that about this set. You know, we've got this kind of creamy color thing and the pants and the blue and the black and the yellow. It's just what seems to be, but it's just a given. There's nothing breaking it apart or thinking that there's any meaning in any of it. So in that sense, it is kind of more of an abstract feeling, because your mind isn't preoccupied with the specifics. If it's given for you to come down to Jacksonville, Florida, which it was, we're coming down. So any of you who are viewing around the world, hop on your jet plane, fly down. Karen Moore Klein will be down there in Jacksonville to greet you, and we'll talk about this book. But that's given. You know, it's just given. And the plane tickets were given, and the Holiday Inn is given, and now it turns out a friend, Amy Torres, from who's probably watching us right now, is coming over from the other coast to stay over on Thursday night with us and interview each of us for an hour at the Holiday Inn. It's just given. Things just come and come and come and come, and we're just welcoming of those things. But it's very different than that figure out mode of trying to figure out what to do, what to say, what's best, what's better, you know, very tiring, that kind of comparative thinking.
Yeah, last time when I did hangout a couple of weeks ago, I had this question which I didn't really see during the hangout, and that question is, what's your practice of meditation? I didn't really answer it, but really that is like everything is put into one category. They're the same, meditation or talking to someone or someone calling on the phone, read a book. They're exactly the same. So there is no practice that is better than the other. It's all completely as like a big flow. I used to say a lot about being guided, which is the direction of the mind, but then it becomes like just a complete effortless flow. And if I find myself sitting in the room for like a couple of hours like I did today, you know, that's fine. That's not necessarily a practice of meditation where to achieve a goal, but it just happens. And if I go out, which I did as well today, that happens. And it's all exactly the same meditative flow. And as you said, there's no figuring out process. So in form, it looks like a lot of specifics are involved. Even in our conversation, we might still talk about specifics, but the mind is not, it's just, it's watching.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You know, it seems too in this world, through the ego's fragmented lens, that there's this belief in private minds and private thoughts, so seemingly everybody has a mind of their own and a past of their own and future ambitions and goals and so forth. It's just a splintered way of looking at the world. But once you get into the flow, we're talking about this flow where you feel the unity of it, the unification of the whole flow, then the forms aren't different. They're actually perceived as the same. So the question about do you meditate, meditation's even seen as a doing or as a practice in time by sitting in a posture or a position or eyes closed or eyes open if you're doing a Zen open-eyed meditation or whatever the particular form is. It could be, you know, there's so many different types of meditation and so forth. But when you get into this flow, which is really a flow of purpose, then everything in form is unified. And you can tell what is the same. Your consciousness is the same. The Holy Spirit's unified consciousness, that's what's the same. And the only thing that is different, not in a reality, is the sense that the Holy Spirit's purpose and the ego's purpose are not the same. Don't ever let the Holy Spirit, you know, the ego is going to try to tell you that they can be the same, and it will try to pretend to be the Holy Spirit. But actually, the ego's purpose and the Holy Spirit's purpose are different. Love and fear are not the same. And then this split in the mind between love and fear, a split mind, gets projected out as if the images are all different too. But once you have a unified awareness and you see the forgiven world, the happy dream, then everything becomes the same. And in that sense, it's a very vast kind of abstract feeling. It's not the pure abstraction of heaven, which is literally beyond concepts entirely, but it's a unified concept, you might say. That's what forgiveness is. It's the last illusion. So that's a key discernment. If you go through this whole book and you get closer and closer to what is the same and what is different, you know, you start to see that the healed mind is the same, and the world, which is not outside of that healed mind, is all unified, is all the same. And the only thing that was different was the ego and the Holy Spirit. But that even collapses in this sameness, because in the end there isn't an ego. You don't have unification and the ego. It's gone. So that's good. That was a good question that somebody asked you about that.
Yeah.
Do you meditate? That was the question.
It was the practice of meditating, yeah.
Yeah. It's a practice.
Okay.
Very good. All we can do is blow you kisses.
Thank you.
And thank you, yeah. Thank you for tuning in. What's that word? Thank you for joining us. And for those of you in Europe that stayed up to the wee hours of the morning, there was a request to maybe do something sometime.
That suits the time zone of Europe. Yes. So, yeah, we will definitely put that into consideration.
Yes, we'll consider that, because we felt with Mexico, the United States, and Australia, this would be a reasonable time as far as what they call sleep times. Believe in this, but we know that you've been requesting something over in Europe. Some of you, though, is that I'm going to try to stay up. So if you're still can hear me, that's fine. If you're snoring, then that's fine too. Sweet dreams.
Okay, thank you. Bye.